The United States has been at war in Afghanistan for over 17 years. If the war in Afghanistan were a human being, it would now be old enough to join the military and vote. It is the longest running war in US history. The war in Afghanistan is 3 years older than Facebook and 4 years older than YouTube itself, the very platform you are watching this on. Those born in 2002 who will first be eligible to vote in the 2020 election have never lived in a world where the US was not fighting a war in Afghanistan. 17 years later, on a tired battlefield, war has become routine. Afghanistan remains the war we can't win, but can't afford to lose. As of August 2016, it is estimated that the US has spent a total of $3.69 trillion on wars in Iraq, Pakistan, Afghanistan, and Syria.
And that is expected to rise further still to an astronomical $4.79 trillion total.
And unfortunately, the war in Afghanistan is just the tip of the iceberg. For as divisive as American politics may be, for as much as we've fractured politically, become more partisan and more polarized and been disrupted, there is one issue on which we are completely united as a nation. There is one issue on which all Americans, white or black, Republican or Democrat, find perfect agreement. There is one status quo so taboo, one policy left unchallenged for so long, people have forgotten criticism is even an option. That issue is America's forever wars in the Middle East. Thanks to the brazen, clumsy actions of one prince, soon to be king, we have a once-in-a-generation opening to question and criticize one of America's longest-standing, most influential, and most bloody alliances. And that window will not be open for very long. We can begin to look to the murder of one man, one journalist, to begin to see the fracturing seams. We can begin to understand through this alliance how America would inadvertently create the very same oil wealth that would later fund the same Islamic extremism the US would spend trillions waging war against. And if you, like me, wonder why Trump's first foreign trip abroad as president was to Riyadh, Saudi Arabia, after pointedly calling for
a total and complete shutdown of Muslims entering the United States.
If you, like me, wondered why in enacting that very same ban, Saudi Arabia, despite being the literal center of the Muslim world and the birthplace of 15 of the 9/11 hijackers, was auspiciously excluded from the list of banned countries. If you, like me, watched in silent wonderment and befuddlement as the President of the United States, Donald J. Trump, shared orbs with the custodian of the two holy mosques, then this is for you. If you want to understand the true mindfuck of this moment, the new depths of irony that this moment embodies, keep watching. I mean, what is this place? It looks like they got a fucking aggro crag in the back of it. And after all, how do you get from
I think Islam hates us
to Saudi sword dancing? And in short, have you ever wondered exactly what is America's obsession with Middle Eastern oil? The same failed foreign policy establishment zombies that have led us into one ruinous and unaffordable quagmire after another are betting your attention span won't last long enough to put the pieces together. But in making this video, I'm hoping they bet wrong. I am willing to believe this can change. But in order for that to happen, you have to pay attention. In order for wars to end, for those with true wealth and power to face accountability, the facts must be known to all. We, through our own willful ignorance on the subject of Middle East politics and culture, and ignorance of our government's deep involvement, have allowed things to get this bad. We are being taken advantage of. It must end. But first, about that journalist.
Thank you.
Our story opens with this man. This is Mohammed bin Salman. He is the crown prince of Saudi Arabia. Recently, he leapfrogged several positions ahead to be the heir to the throne, the billion-dollar fortune. He's known for his lavish lifestyle and hard partying ways. He's also known for trying to be a reformer and has recently been seen wheeling and dealing with President Trump in the Oval Office.
We've become very good friends over a fairly short period of time.
We'll talk about Trump's friendship with the Saudi royal family in a minute. But for now, let's talk about the guy who got iced, Jamal Khashoggi.
I am Leila.
What he is doing, I called for, and I got fired for when I was an editor of a newspaper, allowing women to drive.
Whoa, 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 women driving? Slow down there, Chairman Mao. Oh, wait, we're actually chill with that now. Never mind. This is Jamal Khashoggi, the Saudi journalist I mentioned earlier. Let's hear what he has to say.
Or for women to be empowered or to limit the power of the religious establishment. I demanded that, and he is doing the right things.
And this is the last day of Jamal Khashoggi's life. Here he is in Turkey, shortly before going to the Istanbul-Saudi conflict, with his fiancée, Hatice Cengiz. Clearly, they're very affectionate towards each other, and very much in love. As Jamal Khashoggi was no longer living in Saudi Arabia, he needed to go to the Saudi consulate in order to collect documents to marry Hatice Cengiz. That is the reason why he was going to this consulate in the first place, to get the papers necessary so that they can be married. This is the couple shortly before what would have been their wedding day. Jamal had expressed concern that something bad might happen going to the consulate, but I'm all too certain that neither of them could have imagined what actually was to befall him. This is the last known footage of Jamal Khashoggi alive. It was October 2nd, 2018 at 1:14 p.m., the last time he was seen in public alive. Just before walking in, he will give two cell phones to Cengiz and instruct her to call for help if he does not reappear. And this is the first twist in our story. Jamal Khashoggi does not leave the consulate. And his disappearance will set off a firestorm of international media attention.
Jamal Khashoggi.
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 Washington Post journalist Jamal Khashoggi.
And not to be too cynical, but what's going on here? Usually The View doesn't find it necessary to commentate on the assassination of international journalists, let alone Middle Eastern journalists. What is so important about this? Well, when you investigate the brazen nature of the crime and the players who are involved, it becomes quickly apparent the possible impact of this story. These are the assassins checking into the airport. This is them checking into their hotels. Almost every single step they took in Turkey that day was covered and documented on Turkish CCTV, and that is the footage we are now looking at. This is them leaving their hotel to go to the Istanbul Saudi consulate. These are the cars that they drove. Please take special notice of license plates. And this is them preparing to leave. Hatice Cengiz, meanwhile, sat outside waiting for Jamal Khashoggi for 12 hours. Until 1 a.m., without so much as a text back, a message. Long after the embassy closed, she was still there, waiting for him. 12 hours, sitting there, with no idea as to where her future husband might be.
Hiç gelmedi. Yani bu son 25 gün sonra öğrendiğimiz gerçeklerin %10'u bile o gün orada beklerken aklıma gelmedi. Gelmedi yani. Gelmiş olsaydı, ben de onunla beraber girerdim içeriye ya da onu asla oraya göndermezdim.
Cengiz has since gone into a public period of mourning on her social media for Jamal. Even 100 days after the fact, the pain still lingers, the sorrow never leaving her. And this is where things get really gruesome and very, very suspicious. The only other stop that these 15 men made in Istanbul that day was at the Saudi Consul General's house to wheel in several large black suitcases and two large black garbage bags. The employees of the Saudi Consul General were told not to come to work that day, to their great surprise. They stayed here for 4 long hours, wheeling bag after bag into his underground garage, possibly, probably, containing the dismembered body parts of Jamal Khashoggi to be hidden and disposed of.
What we do know is this. These 15 men, one of whom just happened to be a bone saw wielding autopsy specialist, another three of whom just happened to be the personal bodyguards of the Crown Prince Salman, all of whom are Saudi nationals, fly into Istanbul from Riyadh on two private Gulfstreams belonging to Sky Prime Aviation, a company which coincidentally is also based in Riyadh. They check into two separate hotels, both within blocks of the Saudi consulate and the residence of the Saudi consul general. Despite checking in for 3 days, they all left the same night on the same exact planes, also going back to Riyadh, mere hours after leaving the consulate. Saudi Arabia even claimed the consulate cameras were offline on October 2nd for some unspecified reason. They drove all black cars with Saudi diplomatic license plates and spent less than 2 hours in the consulate itself. Oh, and one of the men involved has since died in a mysterious car accident. Another man left wearing, apparently, Jamal Khashoggi's exact clothing that he wore going in, I shit you not, in an attempt to pass him off as a body double. Saudi officials took 2 days to comment on this, initially rejecting all accusation of wrongdoing, and then nearly a month later claiming a fistfight led to Khashoggi's death. Later that same day, October 20th, they revised died in a fistfight to died from a chokehold, to then claiming we don't know where the body is. And then, hey, what the hell do you know? Just like clockwork, they pledge a thorough and complete investigation to ensure something like this will never happen again. It took a month for them to even admit that he was killed. You can't make this shit up, people. Some of the individuals involved are indispensable to the Crown Prince, namely Maher Abdulaziz Mutreb, who is pretty much always by his side. Other than a few domestic bootlickers, most politicians are being pretty unsparing in their reactions. Republicans and Democrats have come together in rare shows of bipartisanship to try to pull U.S. support for the Saudi-led war in Yemen. Saudi Arabia is also no stranger to such stunts, having once kidnapped the Prime Minister of Lebanon and forcing him to resign while keeping him hostage in Saudi Arabia, which he later rescinded. Have you ever heard of such a thing, rescinding your resignation? And then the Crown Prince joked about having done it in the same room as the guy. I mean, if the question is whether or not he has a chutzpah to try to straight up blatantly assassinate someone, I think we have our answer. Finland, Denmark, and Germany have all halted their arms sales to Saudi Arabia in the wake of this brazen murder. Richard Branson has suspended a $1 billion investment he had planned in the country. I mean, Saudi Arabia is the type of country that will pay money to plaster the front page of the New York Times website with advertisements for a WWE special event going on there, then apologize for showing women on TV during that, and arrest anyone who criticized it. With all that being said, it seems like an open and shut case. I mean, they whacked this guy in broad daylight, case closed, let's cut off the arms sales and call it a night, right? The U.S. couldn't possibly continue to arm and fund an autocratic regime in the Middle East, full well knowing that it not only aids and abets extremism, but also vehemently opposes democracy. Right? My America? Do that? Never! Impossible! Chapter 1. Crazy Rich Arabs.
May the 1st, 1939, King Abdulaziz sets off from Dhahran for Ras Tanura and the dispatch of the first tanker load of Saudi oil.
And when His Majesty devolved, he thanked God for blessing us with this wealth.
Great event to the Saudi people themselves. There were many people followed the king to Ras Tanura, and with the turning of the valve, knowing, as the king did very well, knew that this meant an income which would permit the king to give his people things that they couldn't afford before.
Thus, the kingdom had entered the stage of world oil.
Mm-hmm. الشعر بطبيعته ممكن يلمع زي الحرير، ودلوقتي سانسيلك بيظهر الإمكانية دي في مركز إليدا لأبحاث الشعر.
Okay, so Saudi Arabia has a bunch of money. What's the big deal? I mean, how rich can they possibly be, right? Sometimes in the summers, my family will go to Cannes in the south of France. This just happens to coincide with what is known there and in London as supercar season, when wealthy Arabs from the peninsula fly over their insane cars at a small fee of $30,000 per car to show them off in Europe. Take special notice of the license plates, as those are a huge status symbol as well. Jalopnik recently estimated the value of just the license plate as $153,000 per plate. It literally looks like the vehicle selection screen in Need for Speed out here. And you know what's crazy? Compared to the upper echelons of Saudi wealth, these guys are dirt fucking poor. How rich is Saudi Arabia? How fucking rich is Saudi Arabia? In 2018, Saudi Aramco, the state-owned oil company which owns all the oil reserves and wells, was the most profitable company on the planet. More profit than Apple, more than Samsung. They had three times the profit of Microsoft or even JP fucking Morgan. Saudi Arabia also has 100% control of America's largest refinery as of May 2017 in Port Arthur, Texas. This 500-foot superyacht, the Serene, is one of the 10 largest in the world. It has a helipad, a sauna facing the ocean, and a sizable indoor swimming pool. The Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman bought it for the small fee of £452 million, or roughly $585 million. The prince was on vacation in the south of France when he spotted it off the coast. He dispatched an aide to buy it from Yuri Scheffler, the Russian vodka tycoon who owned it. That very same day, Yuri left the yacht. The Saudi prince paid for the entire near $600 million cost of the yacht up front all at once that same day. That same year, the crown prince would shatter art sales records by buying Leonardo da Vinci's Salvator Mundi for a cool $450 million. Also that same year, the crown prince would buy the chateau of Louis XIV near Versailles for $300 million, the world's most expensive home. All of this while the prince was simultaneously arresting hundreds within Saudi Arabia in an attempt to cut down on corruption and curb spending. There are people in Saudi Arabia who collect falcons like they're fucking Pokemon. Wallahuya, they got money. Also, that same year, the former premier of Malaysia posted documents proving that he had received a $138 million gift from the Saudi royal family. In related news, when Secretary of State Mike Pompeo visited Riyadh in the wake of the Khashoggi assassination to confront the Saudis about their heinous crime, $100 million just showed up in his bank account from Saudi Arabia, just a sheer coincidence, you know, just happened, just showed up. Of Saudi Arabia's many oil fields, one stands out as an elephant in the desert, Ghawar, the largest conventional oil field on the planet. This one field has more proven oil reserves than all but seven countries. This one oil field has been producing, on average, 5 million barrels of oil per day, every day, for the last 30 years. This is the highest sustained oil production rate achieved by any single oil field in world history. No other country produces as much crude daily as this one oil field, except for Russia and the United States. Approximately 60 to 65% of all Saudi oil produced between 1948 and 2000 came from Ghawar. Not only do they have Ghawar, the single biggest and highest producing conventional oil field in the world, they also have Safaniya, the largest offshore oil field in the world. So to answer how much wealth they have, how much money they can put behind absolutely whatever they want, there really is no meaningful answer. Nobody has money like these guys. And the fact that the single largest deposit of natural oil wealth on the planet was chanced upon by the same country charged with stewarding Islam's two holiest sites is one of the most important and meaningful accidents of world history and has completely changed the course of humanity. Do you get it yet? La Habibi, you really don't. For me to answer this question, I had to make an entire fucking section of this documentary dedicated to just explaining and hyperbolizing how much money they have, how much wealth they have, how much sheer resource, influence, and power and luck
this one country has. And I'm sure some of you are saying, I get it. For every car in the world, they have that much influence. No, you don't get it. Oil is made in fucking everything. Everything in the world is made using petroleum. Here, I'll show you.
Oh, yes, of course. Fuel oil for ships and to make electricity. Diesel fuel to run large trucks and to operate industrial equipment. Kerosene to make jet fuel, and others which are used to make cloth, plastic containers, videotapes, hairbrushes, tires, transparent food wrap, film, carpet, soap, crayons, paint, linoleum, ink, styrofoam cups, and hundreds of other things used all over the world.
And asphalt, which makes smooth, durable roads. It seems that oil not only runs cars, it even gives them something to run on.
Fishing
diesel
fuel,
kerosene, tires,
the word expensive doesn't exist to them. They have the most and the best of the world's most valuable, most necessary resource. These motherfuckers might as well be leasing access to the goddamn Infinity Stones for how much money they have access to, okay? So, other than yachts and stuff, what are they buying with all that money, huh?
One of the most colorful visits to the presidential cruiser was that of the ruler of Saudi Arabia, King Ibn Saud. The 65-year-old monarch leaves his country for the first time to attend this.
You have to picture this extraordinary moment at the end of World War II. The fateful meeting on February 14, 1945, between the President of the United States, Franklin D. Roosevelt, and the King of Saudi Arabia, Abdulaziz ibn Saud. On one hand, the leader of the free world, a passionate advocate of democracy and freedom, sitting next to an absolute monarch who is accompanied by slaves and astrologers and Bedouin bodyguards. No records were kept of this meeting. But all historians and American policymakers agree that the basis of the discussion was that henceforth the United States would provide the royal family with protection in return for an exclusive American right to develop Saudi Arabia's oil. And every American president since then has reaffirmed the U.S. alliance with Saudi Arabia.
Our relations with Saudi Arabia have been long, close, and cordial. As the venerable Arabic saying has it, our house is your house.
There's an Arab saying, the sands are blowing. And I submit to you, King Fahd, that if the sands of time give us any hint of the future, it is that in the days ahead, the friendship between the Saudi Arabian and American people will be a strong and vital force in the world.
Saudi Arabia, and I get along great with all of them. They buy apartments from me, they spend $40 million, $50 million. Am I supposed to dislike them? I like them very much.
After that fateful February 14th, 1945 meeting between President Roosevelt and the King, the captain of the USS Murphy parted ways with Ibn Saud, and they exchanged gifts. King Saud gave to the captain a golden dagger and traditional Arab robes for the crew. The captain of the destroyer would respond in kind, giving the king two submachine guns and a pair of Navy binoculars. It would be but a small start to America's arms relationship with the Saudis. From 2000 to 2019, the U.S. has sold arms to a total of 202 countries at a total cost of $333 billion. The number one customer for U.S. arms sales in that time was Saudi Arabia, by far, nearly doubling that of the next country, Japan. In 2015, the world's biggest importer of arms was Saudi Arabia. In September 2016, President Barack Obama offered up $115 billion in weapon sales, equipment, and training to Saudi Arabia, the most of any U.S. president in the entire 71-year history of the U.S.-Saudi alliance. Since the very first fires of this brutally many war began in 2015, U.S. arms sales have been a key part of the conflict, and indeed a bloody cornerstone of the U.S.-Saudi relationship since time immemorial. One might say Saudi Arabia is practically swimming in American arms. And most of the time, those guns make it to the Saudi army. Other times, we're not so lucky.
Al-Qaeda. In January 2016, the terrorist group published footage of some of its members holding German MG3 machine guns. It was not limited to this type of gun or the city of Taiz. Just 3 months after the start of Operation Decisive Storm, Germany was the first European country to officially question Saudi Arabia about whether it had passed weapons to a third party. The trigger? This video showing Houthis receiving G3 assault rifles that had been airdropped into Yemen. Saudi Arabia manufactures G3 and G36 assault rifles with a special license from the German company Heckler & Koch. The company also exports MG3 and MG4 machine guns to Saudi Arabia. In February 2016, Al-Mukhlafi received members of a popular resistance battalion who were returning from training. All members of the battalion were armed with Austrian Steyr AUG assault rifles. Arij spotted hundreds of this type of rifle, as well as the Steyr SSG-69 sniper rifle, in many locations in Yemen, including a province controlled by so-called Islamic State. This weapon was for sale in markets and even got into the hands of children. Interestingly, this type of gun was also spotted in the possession of Saudi soldiers before the war in Yemen began. The journalists asked the Austrian manufacturers how the weapons had ended up in Yemen, but received no response from them or from the Austrian government.
The Abu al-Abbas militia, founded by an Al-Qaeda funder, Abu al-Abbas, currently on the US terror list, proudly patrolling the streets of Taiz in US MRAPs.
We only just stopped refueling their planes mid-bombing run in November of 2018. Bombs which have been used to blow up entire school buses full of children have been tied back to the United States by the serial number. And at that point, why not just bomb the kids ourselves? And naturally, $500 million of arms has been misplaced and has ended up in the hands of the rebels and terrorist groups fighting there. The Saudi coalition we are backing has even cut secret deals with Al-Qaeda fighters, straight up paying them to leave certain towns or retreat with weapons in hands, and hundreds more Al-Qaeda members have even joined the coalition directly itself. Yes, that Al-Qaeda. There's even reports that Al-Qaeda's numbers are rising again. This war in Yemen is proving a very fertile recruitment tool, especially when America is willingly looking the other way. UNICEF representatives in Yemen estimate there may be as many as 6,000 child soldiers across the country, some as young as 13, with more getting involved every day. The Saudis are estimated to have spent hundreds of billions of dollars in the war already, in an attempt to force the Iranian-backed Houthi rebels to vacate, and also to resecure their hold over the Bab el-Mandeb, a critical juncture for Middle Eastern oil exports. The United Arab Emirates has donated over $20 million across 2016 and 2017 to the Middle East Institute, a leading Washington think tank, in an attempt to sanitize their engagement in Yemen. The UAE, for what it's worth, operate a network of torture facilities in Yemen, where detainees are literally grilled alive. Since the start of the war in Yemen in March 2015, over 1,000 Saudi troops have been killed. Saudi Arabia tried soft power against Qatar and failed, pushing them closer to Iran in the process. Diplomacy isn't their strong suit. Over half the UK population is unaware this conflict even exists, despite their government using UK tax dollars to send arms there. For young Brits, this is even worse, where a full 63% of 18 to 24s aren't even aware there is an armed conflict in Yemen that their government is currently supporting.
Hi, do you know what's happening in Yemen?
Yemen, off the top of my head, no.
I'm afraid I don't.
No. No, sorry.
What's happening in Yemen?
Oh, man. I have no idea.
Really? Do you know what's happening in Yemen? Sorry.
And as for the country of Yemen itself, how is it doing?
In the villages of Yemen, it's the children who suffer most. Wherever you go, you can see the human cost of this war. 7-month-old Fatima is weak and severely malnourished. She's one of hundreds in this area alone. Her mother, Sarah, tells me she won't stop crying. It breaks my heart, she says. The only thing Sarah can offer her child is water. She's so malnourished herself that she's unable to breastfeed.
As you can plainly see, Yemen has seen better days. And I'm going to level with you people. This shit gets kind of grim. Saudi Arabia coalition forces have hit Yemen with over 17,000 airstrikes over the last 4 years. The main port of Yemen, Hodeidah, has been blockaded by Saudi Arabia for the past 4 years as well. Saudi bombs have targeted infrastructure such as Médecins Sans Frontières / Doctors Without Borders water treatment facilities, leading to not one, not two, but three separate devastating cholera outbreaks, the worst in modern world history. I won't crush your souls too much with this info, but suffice it to say, this is a brutal, grinding, filthy war that 4 years on, Saudi Arabia is not much closer to winning. With or without U.S. support, millions of people are starving. We are directly supporting the creation of another Middle Eastern refugee epidemic. And for all the arms they've purchased from the West, Saudi Arabia is having trouble beating back desert rebels with ancient Soviet AK-47s and RPGs. And after 4 years... With that in mind, and also considering that so many of the arms used in these heinous crimes are made in the USA, I do think it's fair to ask if these arms sales are really worth it. Do these arms deals really create that many American jobs? To be worth all this misery, this death and destruction, is it worth it? So we're going to listen to the God Emperor verbatim. Herr Trump will speak word for word on this issue in this video very shortly. But before we do that, let's just go ahead and put a gigantic triple parentheses around this entire section by stating that when it comes to arms deals, it's pretty hard to top Obama. This is kind of a secret, but Obama is actually a terrible warmonger, both a bigger warmonger than Bush and Trump, and nobody called him out on it because he's a Democrat and he's black, and we just kind of looked the other way when he blew up kids. Who cares? Let's get right into the numbers with the Donald, shall we? All of these criticisms I'm about to lay out, just imagine them applying to Obama times 10, because he actually broke the records for arms deals to the Saudis.
Kaioken! I refuse to go along with this, and I'm seeing through all of your lies, Barack Obama, you wicked, wicked devil!
The fact that I have to talk about this in economic terms is a fucking naked disgrace to humanity. But I have to. This is a crime!
That alone should be enough to make you question this arms relationship. These are bombs blowing up entire fucking families. But unfortunately, the power of the almighty dollar is vastly more universal than basic human empathy and dignity. So I gotta drop an info bomb on y'all, unlike real bombs, which are bad.
$3 billion, $533 million, $525 million. That's peanuts for you. Should have increased it.
I just gotta say that I love the fucking gall of this guy to, while he's listing off these billion-dollar bombs that he's selling this guy to bomb Yemen, he's sitting there joking about it, being like, geez, you motherfuckers really are rich, huh? I mean, you gotta love the guy for that. You really do. So pray tell, dear viewer, why am I zooming in on Trump's arts and crafts homework, the diorama he brought in to show Saudi Arabia how much the value of what he sold them is? So we're looking at about $12.5 billion in finalized arms sales and about 40,000 jobs in key states. So I'm putting these numbers on this here screen for you, viewer, because I respect you, viewer. I like you, viewer. I respect you the way I respect females. Hakeem, next clip! Hakeem! Grind hard, she hit it. Okay, let's just forget that any of us saw that, but remember the numbers, remember the numbers. 40,000 jobs and $12.5 billion in finalized sales, and if you forget, Trump has a helpful little sign. So $12.5 billion, 40,000 jobs. What's so crazy about those numbers?
But we're not going to walk away from Saudi Arabia.
No, I don't want to do that. I don't want to do that. I do not want to do that. And frankly, they have a tremendous order, $110 billion. Every country in the world wanted a piece of that order. We got all of it. Who are we hurting? It's 500,000 jobs. It'll be ultimately $110 billion, the biggest order in the history of our country from an outside military. And I said, we're going to turn that down. Why would we do that?
Whoa, now. That's kind of a big jump then, isn't it? From $12.5 billion to $110 billion, from 40,000 jobs to 500,000 jobs. What changed between the announcement of this arms deal and this interview? What changed?
President Trump proclaimed that Saudi Arabia remains a close American ally following the brutal murder of a Washington Post contributor, Jamal Khashoggi. This after Trump's own CIA concluded the killing was ordered by MBS, Saudi Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman.
For those of you keeping score at home, that's quite a claim. That would mean that this one arms deal is responsible for employing twice as many people as Microsoft and Google. This would mean basically the creation of another Amazon in the United States. 500,000 jobs, 500,000 people, that's an insane thing to claim. It's obviously not true, but here's why. There's two terms to understand if you really want to grasp why the financial impact of these arms deals is pretty much bupkis in reality. The first is offsets, and the second is Vision 2030. An offset is, well, it's basically a complicated legal bribe. An offset is a form of compensation slash deal sweetening to lessen the burden of a large military purchase on the buying government. Most of the time, it means the buying country will refuse to buy the negotiated arms unless they get to manufacture them domestically in their country using their own employees, to the direct detriment of the U.S. manufacturing base. Offsets have been used to pay for everything from Omani fisheries to the first Malaysian astronaut, paid for by the Russian government, to the interesting case of the Northrop Corporation offering $1.5 million to persuade a company in the US to buy a $50 million papermaking machine from Finland instead of an American-based Wisconsinite company if Finland agreed to purchase F-18 fighter jets, which Northrop helps build. Nearly 500,000 jobs have been lost in the U.S. aerospace industry since 1990 because of the increased foreign competition created by offsets. 500,000 jobs! When Lockheed Martin sold F-16s to Poland, as part of an offset agreement, they decided the jet's engines would be built there by Polish workers, not Americans. Despite Boeing having a fully functioning facility in St. Louis, Missouri, a city plenty in need of jobs, when Boeing reached a $3.3 billion agreement to sell 40 F-15K Strike Eagle jets to South Korea, they allowed the wings and front fuselage to be made in Korea again, to the direct detriment of American manufacturing workers. Before negotiation even began on a deal, Northrop Grumman invested tremendously into Abu Dhabi shipbuilding as a pre-offset for future ship orders. Cynthia Brown, president of the American Shipbuilding Association, said this about the deal. The US government should be insisting that foreign governments cease offset policies. They are killing our industry. It's like Pac-Man. It breeds industry cannibalism to the detriment of the U.S. taxpayer. American arms manufacturers have paid for everything from Dutch yarn exports to imported figs and tomatoes and Christmas hams for would-be Danish buyers. The whole system is mad, said Kevin L. Kearns, president of the United States Business and Industrial Council, which represents small businesses. Everything about offsets is totally counter to a free trade philosophy. If we have the world's best armaments, other countries should buy them free and clear. The mice here are in charge of the cheese. As Western countries tone down their domestic defense spending, Gulf countries have picked up the slack, keeping cash flowing to Raytheon, Lockheed, and Boeing et al. And they know they can make basically whatever demand they want of these companies to sweeten the deal, especially when the public is so incredibly clueless and out of the loop about these disgusting deals. And with these becoming an incredibly normal part of arms sales, this effectively means that every U.S. arms sales to a foreign country actually means more jobs leaving the U.S. than being generated here. And do you really think Trump's deal is anything different? The Trump administration approved 16 deals in 2017 and 8 in January 2018 to help foreign countries create arms manufacturing jobs in their countries. So just once again, guys, one more time. We are not creating jobs in America. We are actually shipping jobs overseas. We are creating direct competitors to American industry using tax dollars through the process known as offsets. And not only is this a thing that's been going on for ages, Trump has actually expanded it. He's actually sent even more jobs overseas with this arms deal. So this is from a study that examined these types of offsets and their impact on U.S. industry. These new relationships, combined with the mandatory offset requirements related to offset agreements, may limit future business opportunities for U.S. subcontractors and suppliers and may have negative consequences for the domestic industrial base. Other kinds of offsets, such as technology transfers, may increase research development spending and capital investment in foreign countries for defense or non-defense industries, thereby may help to create or enhance current and future competitors to U.S. industry. So here's another fun little tidbit. The firms producing weapons for foreign sales represent only 200,000 to 300,000 jobs, about one half of 1% of private sector employment. So that is the total amount of people involved in firms producing weapons for foreign sales, 300,000 people. Holy shit. Is that really worth a fucking war in Yemen? Is that really worth creating a refugee crisis? Is that really worth fucking spreading terrorism, handing American arms to Al-Qaeda, just literally taking weapons and giving them to Al-Qaeda? Is that worth it? I don't think so, but whatever. So that's offsets. If you want to read more about it, there's links in the description. What is Vision 2030? Vision 2030 is Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman realizing that, holy shit, it's a bad idea to base your entire economy around one incredibly volatile substance. Not naming any names. And so we need to get some different kind of jobs that aren't related to oil. And part of that Vision 2030 is, and I'll let you read it for yourself, localize more than 50% of the kingdom's military spending by 2030. So when Trump is telling us he created thousands of jobs with his arms deal, he's actually being completely honest. It's just that the jobs he created were in Saudi Arabia. And well, hey, what do you know? Raytheon, Saudi Arabia. A Saudi legal entity wholly owned by Raytheon that will focus on implementing programs to create indigenous defense, aerospace, and security capabilities in the kingdom. How lovely. Okay, whatever. That's Raytheon. What about Lockheed Martin? They've got to be creating 490,000 jobs. more like 1,000. But there will be 10,000 in Saudi Arabia. So that's good for Saudi Arabia, but not America. And that's about the long and short of it. Most of these jobs are going to be created in Saudi Arabia. I looked for another 490,000 jobs. Actually, it would need to be more like 499,000 to comport with Trump's promise, but I could not find anything of that measure. So I know I promised only two reasons as to why all arms sales are mostly bullshit, but it's your lucky day because I have more. Here's a third one. So Saudi Arabia's GDP is only $683 billion a year. How is it then that they can afford, with that GDP, a $110 billion weapon deal? The answer is they can't. That's not how it works. So this is really, really important, and something that I wish more people understood.
And that's why I'm making this video. There is this law called the Arms Export Control Act of 1976, which this law specifies that any major defense equipment valued at $14 million or more, Congress must be formally given notification 30 days before the president can finalize a sale and must be allowed to give their approval. The notification will look like this one, for example, notifying Congress that, hey, the Saudi government might, and I emphasize might, buy a bunch of F-15s and bombs and shit. And this is where the bullshittery happens. The Department of Defense claims an exception to the Freedom of Information Act for FMS, Foreign Military Sales Data. So the inflated congressional notification documents, which are legally required to state everything that might possibly be sold, are the only cost data that the public has access to. So this is one of the foremost ways in which these disgusting companies and the demons who work for and operate them lie and exaggerate to make their stock price go up and to obscure the public's criticism of their vile trade. They don't actually create that much jobs or revenue for the U.S. These companies openly brag about doing this on their own social media. Lockheed Martin received $35.2 billion in taxpayer dollars in 2018. That's more than the total annual budgets of the IRS and the Environmental Protection Agency combined. That's more than NASA, the Department of Justice, and the entire legislative branch, including the House and the Senate, combined annually. 70% of Lockheed Martin sales come from the U.S. government. And they use that taxpayer money to undermine American business and manufacturing for their own profit. Maybe if you pretend that instead of Lockheed Martin doing all these terrible things, it's Anita Sarkeesian, maybe then the YouTube community will get riled up. Yeah, that's much more important. Fucking Anita Sarkeesian. Let's teleport back to a simpler time. The 2016 election. Ah, isn't this nice? We were so innocent once. This was a cute moment. Let's watch and reminisce.
I'm going to issue a lifetime ban against senior executive branch officials lobbying on behalf of a foreign government.
Wow, a lifetime ban against folks lobbying on behalf of a foreign government. That sounds great. Drain the swamp. So Trump appointed this dude, Richard Holt, to the President's Commission on White House Fellowships. And he's a registered lobbyist for Saudi Arabia. When I say registered lobbyist, there is this law from 1938 called the Foreign Agents Registration Act, or FARA. Yes, like the Overwatch character. That requires you to disclose what activities you do on behalf of foreign governments and how much they pay you to do them. Here's Richard Holt's filing. Clear as day, he works for Saudi Arabia. In January of 2017 alone, he got $431,000 from the government of Saudi Arabia. 400 G's, my guy. And Trump appointed him personally. And remember earlier when I said this is the tip of the iceberg? Honestly, it's really just icebergs all the way down. According to research in Mitchell Bard's The Arab Lobby, the Saudi government has paid over $100 million to U.S. lobbyists over the last 10 years. In the year 2018 alone, according to Open Secrets data, Saudi Arabia has spent well over $10 million influencing the U.S. government. Saudi leaders have been using their immense money and power over the United States and Europe to change the law as they see fit. This has led to the now mythical status of what has come to be known as the 28 Pages. Way back in 2002, when the Joint Inquiry into Intelligence Community Activities before and after the terrorist attacks of September 11, 2001, published their findings in the 9/11 Commission report, at the very end, 28 pages relating to financial and logistical support for the hijackers being provided by Saudi officials and the Saudi royal family were completely blanked out, classified by the Bush administration.
I remain deeply disturbed by the amount of material that has been censored from this report.
Bob Graham won't discuss the classified information in the 28 pages. He will say only that they outline a network of people that he believes supported the hijackers while they were in the U.S.
You believe that support came from Saudi Arabia?
Substantially.
And when we say the Saudis, you mean the government? Rich people in the country? Charities?
All of the above. I think it is implausible to believe that 19 people, most of whom didn't speak English, most of whom had never been in the United States before, many of whom didn't have a high school education, could have carried out such a complicated task without some support from within the United States.
And you believe that the 28 pages are crucial to this.
I think they are a key part.
Yeah, well, the 28 pages do show a direct line of money going through the Saudi embassy in Washington, D.C., out to California, to these hijackers, through their handlers. So it shows the direct line. To me, it's indisputable that the Saudi government was involved when you look at the 28 pages. There's no more argument.
It took over 13 years to successfully win the legal battle to give the public access to this information. It was only declassified in 2016, the very last year of Obama's presidency, when the public was far too distracted and ADD-addled to pay attention. Even Robert Mueller has done his part to keep the Saudi secret safe from the public. Yes, that Robert Mueller.
Porter Goss, who was Graham's Republican co-chairman on the House side of the joint inquiry, and later director of the CIA, also felt strongly that an uncensored version of the 28 pages should be included in the final report. The two men made their case to the FBI and its then director, Robert Mueller, in a face-to-face meeting.
They pushed back very hard on the 28 pages, and they said, no, that cannot be unclassified at this time.
Did you happen to ask the FBI director why it was classified?
We did in a general way, and the answer was because we said so and it needs to be classified.
The last three American presidents, including Obama and now Trump, and even Tony Blair, have all done their part to shield Saudi Arabia from facing any repercussions for their support for the groups and individuals involved in perpetrating the 9/11 attacks. The Kingdom of Saudi Arabia was quick to reward Trump with a huge arms deal he could tout as a quick foreign policy win soon after getting elected. And in return, they expect Trump to repeal the JASTA Act, passed by Congress in spite of Obama's veto, which was overridden, to shield the kingdom and the royal family from any legal or financial liability for the death of the 9/11 victims. And as for the 28 pages, dirty classified now, right? Let's give them a read. First page, first sentence. While in the United States, some of the September the 11th hijackers were in contact with and received support or assistance from individuals who may be connected to the Saudi government. There is information, primarily from FBI sources, that at least two of those individuals were alleged by some to be Saudi intelligence officers. And furthermore... Just kidding. I won't belabor the point too hard. The evidence that high-ranking individuals of the Saudi royal family, namely Prince Bandar, and Saudi intelligence officials gave direct material and financial support to the hijackers is ample and vast and could be a documentary unto itself. Let's focus on something a bit more fun and a bit more spicy. What's in it for Trump? Seriously. He's made it abundantly clear with his Muslim ban and rhetoric that he's not particularly keen on Islam. What's with his being buddy-buddy with the Saudis all of a sudden? Why is he covering up for these guys? Well, actually, it's not really all of a sudden. It's a relationship that spans back decades, well before he would even run for president or insinuate that Obama was born on Mars or whatever. The year is 1991. Trump had fallen upon some hard times. Not quite yet the business magnate he would come to be. And regrettably, he would be forced to sell his precious yacht, the Trump Princess. Can we take a look at this fucking thing here for a second, folks? It looks like the inside of a beeper. It's a 90s status symbol, don't worry about it. It's hard to imagine something more iconically glitzy, glamorous, and uniquely late 80s, early 90s sleaze than the inside of this boat. Who could buy such a thing? Why, none other than wealthy Saudi Prince Al-Waleed bin Talal. That's who. In 1995, as Trump neared bankruptcy, a group of Singaporean investors, and again, Al-Waleed bin Talal, bought him out of the Plaza Hotel for $325 million, coming to his financial aid just in time. In 2016, it was reported that Trump sold the entire 45th floor of the Trump World Tower to the Saudi government for $4.5 million in June of 2001. Assuming common charges and fees stay the same, the five apartments, including 10 bedrooms and 13 bathrooms, would mean Trump was paid at least $5.7 million by the Saudi government since 2001. I know what some of you guys are saying. This is fake news, this is bullshit, you can't prove any of that. Trump is America first, he would never do any of that. Actually.
I'll give you another example. Saudi Arabia. They make $1 billion a day. $1 billion a day. I love the Saudis, many are in this building. We need to make great deals with other countries. Saudi Arabia, I like the Saudis, they're very nice. I make a lot of money with them.
They buy all sorts of my stuff. All kinds of toys from Trump. They pay me millions and hundreds of millions. Saudi Arabia, and I have great relationships with Saudi Arabia, as I do with Mexico, as I do with everybody. You know, they all buy apartments from me. They pay millions and millions of dollars. Am I supposed to dislike them? I love them. China. I sell apartments for 50 million, 30 million, 25 million, 18 million. Some of the cheap ones, like 10 million. Okay, those are the cheap ones. I don't even bother to sign those contracts. But I get it from Saudi Arabia. I get it from Japan. I get it from everybody. I love these people. And I have many friends in Saudi Arabia. They're good people. Talk about people buying apartments. I mean, they get so much money, they don't know what to do. They make my plane look small. I'm very embarrassed.
And this just makes Trump's peculiar over-denial of his financial ties to Saudi Arabia all the more bizarre. And, well, so what's the big deal? What kind of people are the Saudis anyways? What kind of country is Saudi Arabia? They can't be that bad. The prince is a moderate reformer. There are regional allies. We need to stay the course and arm the moderate rebels. How different can their beliefs really be?
A Sudanese man who is about to be beheaded in a parking lot on his knees, hunched over with a blindfold on in front of dozens of people because...
11,000 miles from San Francisco. 8,000 miles from New York. There lies a primeval desert, a mass of drifting sand and sun-baked earth, one-third the size of the United States. A place of ancient glories, long ago a center of thriving trade where came the merchants from India and China to barter their wares for the spices and the incense. In the early 1930s, an American oil company obtained a concession on Bahrain Island, 25 miles out on the Persian Gulf. The venture was successful. And occasionally there was speculation as to whether even greater opportunities might lie across the green waters of the Gulf in Saudi Arabia. Whether these unknown sands would justify the outlay of millions of dollars was still a decision that had to be made by the company directors in San Francisco, 11,000 miles away. There was a meeting at Kazem Palace on the outskirts of Jeddah. It was there that Saudi Arab government officials representing His Majesty signed a concession covering roughly 320,000 square miles. This was the starting point of a new American business venture abroad. And then, at Dammam, it happened. Oil in commercial quantities had been brought in after three long, discouraging years. A long road has been traveled since those early years. There have been changes and great expansion. The original concession has been enlarged and now embraces an area of 440,000 square miles, equal to the states of California and Texas combined. The Navy has said that Saudi Arabian oil is one of its most important strategic sources of supply. Who are working for the economic recovery of Europe see Middle Eastern oil helping them in their labor, day in and day out. It is making available the vast volumes of petroleum needed to fuel the job of rebuilding the war-scarred Eastern Hemisphere. Thus, American venture capital is developing new standards of life in an ancient realm where a people with a glorious past are now building a glowing future with their partners from the other side of the world and demonstrating the vitality of the American system of free enterprise. A system which, from this new frontier, is pumping into the trade of the world oil, one of the materials that is making a truly great contribution to our modern civilization.
الجميع اذا اجمعوا الفقيمون.
to understand how uniquely intertwined Saudi Arabia is with the ideology of extremist fundamentalist Islam and the preachers and edicts that would go on to inspire Daesh, sorry kafirs, that's ISIS too. To understand that connection, we must travel through time to examine a pact between a desert warrior and a young, ambitious, and deeply radical preacher by the name of Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab. This pact, made in the shadows of the Ottoman Empire, still holds true hundreds of years later as the basis of Saudi power today. This is how we get from Arabia, as in Lawrence of Arabia, to Saudi Arabia, as in the Arabia of the Sauds. And some of you, I'm sure, are saying, why do I care about this ancient Muslim history? I barely care about my own history. Well, there's a reason that in Osama bin Laden's original 1996 fatwa calling for Mujahideen to wage holy war against the United States, he cites one specific preacher, Ahmad ibn Taymiyyah, six separate times. There's a reason that when ISIS decided to film themselves burning a Jordanian Muslim pilot alive, they again cited the same Ibn Taymiyyah to justify their actions. And there's a reason why Colonel Gaddafi, that lovable old cad, told Americans in the wake of 9/11, if you want to combat terrorism, bomb London and Riyadh. In 1744, the Arabian Peninsula was a poor, resourceless desert backwater, isolated from most of the world and deplete of natural resources. In the wake of various collapsed caliphates, what is now known as Saudi Arabia was a lawless land, ruled by sword-wielding nomads on camelback. Amidst this tribal chaos, one man sought to unite the tribes and create a new order. That man was Muhammad ibn Saud, the founder of the first Saudi state and the patriarch of the Al Saud clan, after which Saudi Arabia is now named. But Ibn Saud had a problem. To expand his relatively small new state outside of Najd, the central region of Saudi Arabia, which is roughly where Riyadh is today, he needed something bigger than himself. He needed to rally and inspire people to a greater cause, something they would be willing to fight and even die for. He needed a moral justification to raid, kill, or convert neighboring clans and incorporate them into his new expanding state. In short, Ibn Saud needed religion, and in Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, he had found the perfect proselytizer. The pact they made went as follows. The oasis is yours. Do not fear your enemies. By the name of God, if all Najd was summoned to throw you out, we will never agree to expel you. To which Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab replied, you are the settlement's chief and wise man. I want you to grant me an oath that you will perform jihad against the unbelievers. In return, you will be imam, leader of the Muslim community, and I will be leader in religious matters. To seal this pact, Muhammad bin Saud's son and Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab's daughter will be married off, and the alliance that they forged is still the basis of Saudi power today. The descendants of Al Saud would be the political leaders of the Saudi state from then on, until the creation of the modern kingdom of Saudi Arabia in 1932. The children of bin Abdul Wahhab, however, would become the Al-Ashik family, which lead the ulema, the leaders of Islamic thought in the country, which are the authority in all religious matters and are the last word on what constitutes acceptable thought and behavior in the country. The original alliance of Muhammad bin Saud and Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab would culminate in the 1802 sack of Karbala, where 12,000 of the Ikhwan, the Saudi Wahhabi religious army, would crusade into Karbala, now part of modern-day Iraq, then part of the Ottoman Empire, and slaughter 4,000 individuals, women, children, the old, even pregnant women, everyone, and plundered their wealth. This audacious assault would earn the ire of the Ottoman Empire, which would launch a counterattack, destroying the first Saudi state. A few hundred years later, after the Ottoman Empire collapsed around 1918, the descendants of Muhammad bin Saud and Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab would return and finish their forefathers' work, creating the modern Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, the third Saudi state, in 1932. Only six very short years later, in 1938, they would find vast quantities of oil at the number 7 well in Dammam, and the rest, as you know, is history. This unique blend of political and religious ideology embodied in this alliance would come to be known as Wahhabism, the official state-sponsored religion of Saudi Arabia, and there's quite a few things which separate it from mainstream Islam. Now, I'm skipping over a lot here, and if you really want to get down and dirty, I'm going to flash two things quickly that expand on these topics and that will also be linked below in the description. This documentary on Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab and Wahhabism here, and then this seminar on precisely how different Wahhabi's views are from mainstream Islam, they're both in the description. Any Wahhabi Muslim watching this will tell you there's no such thing as Wahhabism.
Even the crown prince himself, they just call it Islam. This harkens back to the central principle of Wahhabism, Tawhid, or the oneness of God. They believe in one of the most strict and literal interpretations of Islam. And remember that not only does this persist into modern Saudi Arabia, that the very same Saudi Arabia, which endorses Wahhabism and also has control of Islam's two holiest sites, Mecca and Medina, lending religious preachers their automatic credibility, also happens to have the greatest oil wealth on the planet, with which they can promote their literalist, puritanical view of Islam. And boy, do they promote. Now, the term Wahhabi was actually first coined by Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab's lesser-known older brother, Sulayman bin Abdul Wahhab, who published a significant refutation of his brother's theological writings entitled The Divine Lightning and Refutation of the Wahhabis. Wahhabis are definitely a real thing, and it's fair to use that term. So, from the very first moment of its existence, Wahhabism has been a controversial ideology, even criticized thoroughly by Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab's own brother. So, what exactly do they believe? Being extreme literalists, they believe God, Allah, possesses an actual physical form, including hands, legs, eyes, and a face, and sits on a physical throne. This is already a huge departure from mainstream Islam, who believe depicting Allah or ascribing human qualities to him to be sacrilege. They really hate shrines, tombstones, building monuments on graves, visiting graves, or honoring the dead, as they believe this equates to worshiping the dead, or an act of intercession, or praying to the dead individual to act on your behalf, or praying to the dead individual instead of God, or asking them to intervene and do something for you other than God, Allah himself. They would call this shirk or polytheism, idol worship. In an extreme example, after conquering Medina, the then ruling Saudi Wahhabi clan would destroy the Al-Baqi Cemetery, where the prophet of Islam's own son, Ibrahim, is buried. In the following clip, which perfectly illustrates the Wahhabi mindset, this TV show host argues with Wahhabi, who wants to destroy the Prophet Muhammad's tomb for promoting shirk, and then threatens to kill the host for disagreeing. Suffice it to say, the vast majority of Muslims don't want to fucking destroy Muhammad's tomb. This is an extreme belief.
يعني أنت الآن لو يتاح لك فرصة تقتلني؟
نعم.
بالله.
والله.
يعني لو جيبوا لك سكين تنحرني؟
أول شيء أنا أستثيبك.
يعني أنا قلت.
مو أستثيبك. أبين لك الحق لعل الله يهديك وانتفع بإيمانك هذا. لكن لا أكون يعني قاسي معك بدرجة إني أكون بس عطشا للدم. أبين لك الحق. وبين أن هناك جنة ونار
ونجد. أنا مؤمن بالله إلا حقتك ذي الثانية قبر النبوي
القبر النبوي
خلي بكلم يعني أنت الآن أنت كفرتني صح؟ لأني أنا مع علماء المملكة في هذا الموضوع طيب خلي بعلم
يا أخي ما هذا منكر والله ما منكر أول شيء نقر إنه منكر والله ما هو
أنا ما أدري أنا أمشي مع العلماء
العلماء يقولوا منكر
ما قالوا قال ما لا ما قالوا نشيلوا المساجد القبور دي من المساجد
قالوا منكر
قالوا منكر قالوا هيئة كبار العلماء من بنى قبر أو رفع رفع في قبور والتمسح بها والاعتقاد أنها تنفع من دون الله فهو كفر
نعم
هذا شرك بعد
حتى إدخالها في المساجد كفر
أيوة بس الآن نتكلم هم يتكلمون عن حالة الخاصة
هذه ما هي خاصة من الذي فعلها
أصبر بس الحين أنت لو الآن أنا على ما أنا عليه الآن معه تبي تذبحني برصاصة ولا نحر
والله حسب ما تيسر
ما جاولك إلا سكين
سكين عبد الله المستعان
لا ما في خنق. يعني معناته أن القتل
إذا ما في سكين خنق
خنق طيب.
When the former king of Saudi Arabia, King Abdullah, died, he was buried in an unmarked hole in the ground in a simple cloth. Compare, for example, this mausoleum for the former king of Morocco, or the magnificent Shah Cheragh Shrine and Funerary Monument Mosque in Iran. Who else do we know that goes out of their way to bizarre extremes, to destroy mausoleums, tombstones, statues, Buddhas, funerary monuments, other Muslims, anything that stands in the way of their one particular Salafi interpretation of Sunni Islam? I mean, I don't know. I'm totally stumped. I can't think of any examples. Can you guys? I'm just totally missing on this one. Oh, and last thing, Wahhabis really, really hate Shias, like a lot.
وفهم مسلمون إخواننا
هذا اللي يقول هذا الكلام جاهل مركب جاهل الرافضة شأنهم خطير هم عباد وأوثان
سلوا سيوفكم
وعليكم أولا بالرافضة حيثما وجدتموهم.
And this is emphasized in Saudi Arabia's own religious textbooks, the statements of the government officials, and in how they govern their own country. Well, we all have our disagreements. Surely we can work these out peacefully in a civilized manner. At least, you know, among other Muslims, maybe, perhaps. Those people who ask for intercession from prophets and angels, it is permitted to kill them and to take their possessions. Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab. Here is Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab quoted directly in ISIS's own official magazine, Dabiq, Dabiq issue 6, page 11. Jihad is to continue with every imam, whether he is righteous or sinful. It is obligatory to obey the imams of the Muslims, both the righteous and the sinful, as long as they do not order you to disobey Allah. Even Winston Churchill had some thoughts to share about the Wahhabis after encountering them. A large number of Ibn Saud's followers belong to the Wahhabi sect, a form of Mohammedanism which bears, roughly speaking, the same relation to Orthodox Islam as the most militant form of Calvinism would have borne to Rome in the fiercest times of the religious wars. The Wahhabis profess a life of exceeding austerity. What they practice themselves, they rigorously enforce on others. They hold it as an article of duty as well as of faith to kill all who do not share their opinions and to make slaves of their wives and children. And what about this Ibn Taymiyyah, the guy ISIS and Osama cited? What's he got to do with this? Well, he was the premier scholar who influenced Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab, and jihadis and extreme Salafists conveniently leave out the very particular context of his life when citing his writings justifying violence. Ibn Taymiyyah was born in 1263 and died in 1328, and in his era, a nearly 100-year-long Mongolian invasion of Muslim lands racked the Muslim world. Muslims were basically being hunted down by Mongol forces. For example, Mongolian Khanate would lay siege to Baghdad in the process, kill nearly 1 million people before the invention of gunpowder. 1 million people by the sword alone. Taymiyyah's parents, fleeing the Mongol hordes, would try to start anew in Damascus with their young son, his worldview shaped by the horrors of the pursuing Mongol army. So what sort of stuff did he say? Who is this guy that had such a powerful impact on Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab, the spiritual founder of Saudi Arabia and of Wahhabism? The adulterers, homosexuals, the innovators, and the alcoholics. Whoever does not shun their company is committing a despicable deed. Know that jihad is the finest thing in this world. One of Taymiyyah's most important ideas was to expand the usage of the act of takfir, the excommunication and disregarding of the faith, the annulling of faith of self-professed Muslims, which he used to condemn the Mongol invaders en masse. And this was one of the ideas that his pupil, Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab, would take to heart, allowing for mass excommunication of any Muslims which don't abide by Wahhabi Salafist practices. This same concept is what Islamic extremists like Al-Qaeda and ISIS, Daesh, used to justify their mass terror campaigns against their fellow Muslims. Okay, so Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab, Wahhabism, Ibn Taymiyyah, they definitely had some beliefs that are a bit out there. Thankfully, they're a minority in Saudi Arabia, right? This is pretty much contained there, right? We don't have to worry about this too much, right? Well, not to be the bearer of bad news, we already have amply demonstrated that these guys have money to spend and love to spend it. And this is in another league entirely. Remember that the Al Saud clan is of no particular religious lineage. They derive religious legitimacy from the ulema, who demand that they prove their commitment to this austere religion by spending vast sums of money to promote and export this form of Islam as the dominant form of Islam throughout the globe. This is how such gaudy, ostentatious spending and swanky lifestyles can coexist alongside the holiest sites in Islam and among the most restrictive interpretations of the religion itself. Now, I know I don't have a smug British accent, and I'm not ranting about how feminist SJW cultural Marxists are Stalinizing Roblox or anything that the YouTube audience might really connect with here, but hear me out. It's important to know and understand these things, because if we don't, we get the crown prince playing stupid, acting like he's never heard of Wahhabism before, or Wahhabi saying there's no such thing as Wahhabism. For example, we've all heard of Molenbeek, the neighborhood in Brussels, Belgium, known to have produced many of Europe's most nefarious jihadi terrorists. How did this quaint little Belgian neighborhood become such a source for hardened Wahhabi terrorists? In 1967, the king of Saudi Arabia just happened to be visiting Belgium when a huge fire in a department store claimed the lives of 323 people, many of them Moroccan and Turkish industrial workers themselves recently arrived in 1964. The king was moved by this tragedy and donated huge sums of money to the family's victims, for which they were handed the keys to Brussels' Great Mosque, the oldest in the country. Recently, some of the teaching manuals in this mosque, provided by Gulf Arab states, called for gays to be stoned to death and thrown off buildings, and described Jews as evil.
Now, more than 600 fundamentalist Salafi teachers have moved into Islamic schools through Brussels to spread their Saudi strain of Islam. And this is just one mosque Saudi Arabia has sponsored. In Bangladesh, the Saudis have invested into building 560 mosques. And slowly, we've seen extremism slowly creep in there as well. Say what you will about the New York Times, but I think they nailed it when they described Saudi Arabia on the issue of Islamic terrorism as both the arsonists and the firefighters. Recently, Saudi Arabia has their eyes set upon India. During a single two-year period between 2011 and 2013, 25,000 Wahhabis visited India for missionary work. Over that period, they invested $250 million to propagate Wahhabism, $460 million to set up madrasas, and another $1.2 billion for four universities. Malaysians are feeling the pressure too, where some warn that the Saudi influence on Islam in Malaysia has come at the expense of traditional Malay culture. Two annual beer festivals were cancelled after Islamic leaders objected. Malaysia is becoming Arabized by never-ending streams of Saudi money. Another poignant example, Indonesia, as the most populous Muslim nation on earth, was not to be ignored by the Saudi money hoes either. In 2000, 75% of Indonesians said they had a favorable opinion of the United States. In 2003, after Wahhabism started to take hold, 83% of Indonesians had an unfavorable opinion towards the US. 3 years difference. The infamous 2002 Bali bombers themselves were products of a Salafi Wahhabi school that the Saudis had built in Indonesia, Lipia, which forbids music, television, jeans, and loud laughter. East Africa, too, has seen a huge spike of religious extremism and polarization as more and more students from East Africa study abroad in Gulf State universities. Even the Islamic extremism of Putin's beloved Chechnya can be tied back to Saudi Wahhabist ideologues and fighters, inspiring some to undertake acts of suicide bombing. Saudi Wahhabist hardline preachers were openly indoctrinating young Chechens as early as 1997. In 1956, there were 244 madrasas in Pakistan. Today, there are 24,000. Tsunamis of Saudi money have been too potent for an otherwise poor country to turn down. The San Bernardino, California shooters who killed 14 were alleged to have been radicalized from their family's moderate Islam by the years they had spent abroad in Saudi Arabia. The brother of one of the shooters said, "Our brother went to Saudi, and since then, he doesn't care about anyone here." Adel Batterjee, a wealthy Saudi businessman, financed jihadis in Bosnia from 2,000 miles away in Jeddah. Al-Shabaab of Somalia, which some of you may have heard of, destroyed graves, burial sites, churches, mosques, some hundreds of years old, in accordance with their Wahhabi belief system. According to some estimates, since the 1960s, Saudis have spent over $100 billion funding schools and mosques all over the world in an attempt to spread Salafi Wahhabist ideology far and wide. As a point of comparison, it's estimated that the former Soviet Union spent about $7 billion exporting communist ideology from 1920 to 1991. So, in 40 years, Saudi Arabia spent more than 10 times the amount of money the Soviet Union spent exporting communism in almost 100 years. Holy fucking shit. State-sanctioned Saudi clerics, again, on the government salary, were openly calling for violent jihad against Americans in Iraq in 2005, 4 years after 9/11. In non-Muslim majority countries alone, Saudi Arabia would build 1,359 mosques, 210 Islamic centers, 210 colleges, 2,000 schools. The European Parliament put together probably the best report on this of anyone I've read. It's incredibly well-researched and thorough, and it will be linked in the description. In October of 2001, in an interview with PBS, Vali Nasser, an associate professor of political science at the University of San Diego who specializes in Islamic extremism, elaborated on how Wahhabism directly ties into the entrenchment of rigid fanaticism throughout the Muslim world. These interpretations of Islam are being propagated out of schools that receive organizational and financial funding from Saudi Arabia. In fact, I would push it further, that these schools would not have existed without Saudi funding. They would not have proliferated across Pakistan and India and Afghanistan without Saudi funding. They would not have had the kind of prowess that they have without Saudi funding, and they would not have trained as many people without Saudi funding. As another researcher put it, not all angry and extreme German nationalists in that period were or became Nazis. But just as angry and extreme German nationalism of that period was the soil in which Nazism grew, Wahhabi and Islamic extremism today is the soil in which Al-Qaeda and its sister terrorist organizations are growing. Well, if this is truly such a deviant strain of Islam, something so apart from the mainstream, where are all the Muslim voices criticizing them? I've never heard any. Granted, I don't know any Muslims, and I can't hear a single word of Arabic without my brain exploding, but still, if there were Muslims criticizing this, I would have heard of it, for sure. Well, I'm so glad you're so keenly interested. Allow me to show you.
But there is one country where there is no difference between it and ISIS, and that is Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia is the root of ISIS. If Saudi Arabia tells you it has a problem with ISIS, what's the problem? You have a problem with executions, you execute. Beheadings, you behead. Anti-Shia, you're anti-Shia. Anti-Christian, you're anti-Christian. Plurality of opinion, you've got a problem when it comes to plurality of opinions. When Saudi Arabia gives you the rhetoric that it's against ISIS, it's the biggest load of nonsense politically in this world. Saudi Arabia has absolutely no problem with ISIS whatsoever. Saudi Arabia's only problem is that the call for caliphate within ISIS means there's a threat to their leadership. Otherwise, the vision of ISIS is the vision of Saudi. The complete destruction of Shiism, the complete destruction of Christianity, the complete killing of those who go towards the graves, the killing of those who believe in intercession. And further than that, execution and beheading is something normal. If you look at the rhetoric of ISIS and the rhetoric of Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab, the ideologue of the Wahhabi school in Saudi Arabia, there is absolutely no difference between the rhetoric of ISIS and the rhetoric of the Wahhabis. And I, by the way, I'm calling them Wahhabis. They don't like to be called Wahhabis. They like to be called Salafis, yes? And they kept on saying, why doesn't so-and-so have democracy? Why? Do you have democracy in Saudi Arabia for you to tell the world about democracy? And it's high time the non-Muslim world knew the biggest problem is the country with the best oil. Make a decision. You can't turn around and have it both ways. Either diplomatic relations are cut, or do not be surprised if there isn't another terrorist bomb in this part of the world. America, Europe, Africa, young Sunni kids are being brought up on Ibn Taymiyyah and Ibn al-Qayyim.
رجل الدين لازم يكون محترم نفسه ومحترم عقول الناس. ورجل الدين يجب أن لا يتورط في الفتنة. مين قال إنه الله يعني يسمح بفتنة بين الناس؟ مين قال إنه الله سبحانه وتعالى يسمح بالقتل؟ مين قال إنه الأديان بتسمح بالقتل وبتحليل دم الناس؟ حتى لو كان واحد من غير دينك، لكن أنا بتطلع بتحلله دمه هو رافضة روافض أو هم بعرف شو أو بكفر الناس. مين هو هذا تيكفر الناس؟ مينك أنت؟ شو شغلتك بالأمة يعني؟ شو عامل بهذه الأمة يعني أنت؟
هني بيعتبروا إنه
You know, Osama bin Laden was our good friend because he was a freedom fighter in Afghanistan and we gave him our weapons and supported him. But then we found out he was not quite so friendly, so we arrested or captured a few of his men and he retaliated by bombing our embassies. Of course, we retaliated by bombing innocent chemical plants as well as people in Afghanistan that had nothing to do with it. So where are we now? We're back to supporting and working hard and just deliberating over, should we give weapons to the KLA? I mean, the whole thing is absurd.
يجب على كل مسلم في العالم بيقدر يحكي وعنده انترنت وعنده جريدة وعنده إذاعة وعنده تلفزيون أن يدين هذا المجرم, هذا الوحش, هذا القاتل, هذا الهمجي الذي يرسل بنات الأطفال لينفذوا عمليات انتحارية وباسم الله يرسلهم وباسم الإسلام وباسم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. هلا بمعزل أنه عن جد وحدة من هول بنتين هي اللي راحت أو لا, على كل هذا بيعبر عن ثقافة وعن ثقافة مقبولة في أوساط معينة في الأمة. بالمناسبة هذا مش جديد, في نيجيريا عشرات البنات الصغيرات الأطفال من البنات بوكو حرام اللي هي داعش واللي هي قاعدة واللي هي فكر وهابي استخدمت بنات فجرتهم بالأسواق وبالكنائس وبالمساجد وقتل واستشهد المئات من النيجيريين بسبب هذه العمليات الانتحارية. هذا ما بده إدانة, ما بده صرخة. وين في عقل, وين في قلب, وين في دين, وين في شيء له أي صلة بالسماء يمكن أن يقبل أن ترسل طفلا أو طفلة لتفجر نفسها أو لتفجرها أنت عن بعد بأي بأي يعني عن جد شيء مذهل. كل إنسان مؤمن، كل إنسان مسلم، كل إنسان غيور على الإسلام وعلى رسول الإسلام يحترق قلبه عندما يرى هؤلاء المتوحشين الهمجيين التكفيريين القتلة يسيئون إلى هذا الدين وإلى هذا النبي ويسيئون إلى الله سبحانه وتعالى من خلال هذه الجرائم وهذه المنهجية. هل يظن هذا الوزير وحكامه وملوكه وأمراؤه أنه قادرين هم يضلوا يضحكوا على شعوب العالم وعلى رأي العام العالمي؟ العالم ما بدأ يكتشف بوضوح أنه اللي بيذبح كاهن عمره 80 سنة بالكنيسة هيدا صحيح ابن داعش بس هيدا ثقافته من عندكم؟ اللي بيهجم بنيس بيجزر بالعالم، اللي بيقتل بألمانيا وما بتفرق معه مين عم يقتل، المهم عم يقتل ناس مسلمين مسيحيين ما بيهم، اللي بيفجر تظاهرة طالعة عم تطالب بالكهرباء بكابل ما إلى خصة بالسياسي وبيقتل 80 شهيد 250 جريح، اللي بيرتكب جريمة بمستوى جريمة الكرادة في بغداد 300 شهيد في لحظة واحدة رجال ونساء وكبار وصغار بيتفحموا، اللي بيذبح الطفل الفلسطيني في حلب. كل العالم صار بيعرف أن هاي ثقافتكم الوهابية وهاي مدارسكم وهاي مناهج التعليم تبعكم وهاي مشايخكم وهاي إعلامكم وهاي تلفزيوناتكم وقنواتكم المكفرة. مشروعكم ما له مستقبل. السعودية وحكام السعودية أمام فرصة يرجعوا يتداركوا كل الموقف في المنطقة. ما دام اليمني عم بيقول جاهز فاوض، والبحريني جاهز يفاوض، والسوري والعراقي والإيراني وغيرهم طعوا فاوضوا. ما تتكبروا، ما تاخدكم العنجهية ولا يعميكم الحقد. عندكم فرصة تكونوا شركاء في معالجة أوضاع المنطقة ويطلع لكم حصة، تكونوا شركة ويطلع لكم حصة. أما إذا أصريتم على مواصلة هذا النهج وهذه الحروب بكل ثقة وبكل يقين وبكل إيمان أقول لكم ستهزمون. مشروع آل سعود في المنطقة سيهزم وسيلحق به العار. هذا إذا بعدين بقي في نظام اسمه نظام آل سعود، لكن هذا يجب أن يتدارك وبأيديهم هم أن يتدارك. يضمني وهو غطاء حول الرمال تلفني. فرش التراب يضمني وهو غطائي حول الرمال تلفني بل من ورائي واللحد يحكي.
انت لما تخلف في حقيقتك عندك كفر يعني خلاص انت مشرك. قال لك مره انت مشرك، انت مشرك. جاب طرف حديد قال يا اخي صح لك شنو هذا حديد دين وصل المقبرة ربما زمان دفنين دليل عن كيف يقولي سحر الله.
إن كان مكتوب لفظ جلالها مكتوب الله جل جلاله وإنه محمد عليه السلام، وهذه طبعا صورة الفاتحة وغير فلان من ذلك الكتاب بداية صورة البقرة. فلما فلما أصبح اسم محمد عليه السلام جم لفظ الجلالة قال كيف محمد يكون ند الله، فقام الكاتب يعني شهادة لله هذه قام الكاتب فوق من رأسه وضرب على القبر بقرآن يقول هذا الشرك يقول على القبر الشرك يعني حتى الناس مدفونة ما تعرفهاش هذا عمر خلطات يعني مجازف.
فرش التراب يضمني وهو غطائي حول الرمال تلفني.
هذه وقفوا لي نفرين هنا قال لي شنو هالحنة هذه شوفها هيك قلت له شي زرت حنة شي مشكلة يعني قال لي تسجلوا لها تعبدوا فيها هذه
قلت لا اله الا الله محمد رسول الله يا رجل لو امي شيء لله يسبح الحمد ولكن لا تبقى مصبيحه بين حوانق قلت لو امي شيء لله يسبح الحمد قلت لو امي شيء لله يسبح الحمد ولكن وقف
Now, currently standing just outside the gate of the graveyard of the 71 companions which were martyred in the Battle of Uhud and that were buried here. And if you look at some of the historic pictures which were taken at the time, you could see that we could find the actual graves. But now it is a sad sight for us to say and to see that here now, where 71 graves were supposed to be, now we can hardly see any. We can maybe see one in the middle and one on the far right, which we cannot even recognize whose graves they are. Most likely they would be the grave of Hazrat Amir Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu. But the other 70 surrounding graves have been destroyed to the extent that their signal cannot be even found. That is there a grave here or not? Or when we walk on here, are we standing on somebody's grave or not? This is the extent of their hideous and disgusting ideology that it is impossible for us to comprehend. That how can somebody with the right frame of mind do something so disgusting? But then to come to a place where 70 of the greatest companions who fought for us, fought for our religion today, by being saying we are Muslims today so openly and freely, they fought for us, they gave their life for us, and this is the regard and gratefulness that we show to them, that we destroy their graves in such a way that their signs cannot be even found on the earth. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the ability to try to understand as quick as possible the dirty beliefs of the Khariji and the Najdiya people and what they are destroying, and day by day how they will destroy all the heritage of Islam and all the graves of the companions and great people that came before us.
La,
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 la, la, la,
la, la, la, ماشي بسميك
ماشي بسميك
وهوي وتسي سمينو
الإسلام أمانة أما الإرهاب ما عنده ديانة
ماشي بسميت
ماشي بسميت
تورتوري لي زينوسون سي دو لا باربري
ماشي بسميتي
نوت ان ماي نيم
ماشي بسميتي اشكو دينه انياه نعاوني نقراتنا
اسلام حريه واحترام
ماشي بسميتي
حيت الاسلام دين جدودي ووالدي
الاسلام سلوك واخلاق
دين ديالنا اسلام ومعامله
انا خلقناكم شعوب وقبائل لتعارفوا
الاسلام هو نبغيو بعضياتنا
Parce que la jeunesse dit non au terrorisme.
عالم راحت انتهت بالسيارات تفحمت والله العظيم شنو شحتكم ويا العالم شنو انتم من يادين
ليش حرامات على الرياض والاطفال والنساء والشيوخ موظفين
بس انتم ما عندكم ضمير لا دين ولا ضمير
I want to ask this question. I want to ask our own administration why they turn a blind eye from what Saudi Arabia regime has been doing by financing those Wahhabi terrorists around the world and inside Saudi Arabia. And the other question to the Muslim population around the world, what else other than murder and terrorism the sect, the Wahhabi sect, has to offer to the world, other than bloodshed, killing, executing, beheading people in Iraq, in Pakistan, in Saudi Arabia, in Syria, in Yemen? This is the single agenda that the Wahhabis have for the Muslims around the world, that if you do not accept us, then we shall come after you and we shall annihilate you. Unfortunately, this is the lesson that Wahhabis are teaching the world, but unfortunately, who is paying the price for their atrocities? Islam, our religion, that's paying the price for that. And we Muslims need to be more vocal, especially here in America. That what you see around the world, what you see happening in the, around the world, atrocities committed by the Wahhabis has nothing to do with Islam. Those are a bunch of terrorists that Islam would not consider members at all. Those are terrorists who do not represent our faith, but yet, unfortunately, have been successful in hijacking Islam.
In the 17th century, they produced an evil man in Saudi Arabia by the name of Mr. Wahhab, who was concerned about the decline of the Muslim world. But he hit upon a wrong remedy. He seized upon one surah in the Quran. It is this Wahhabi version of Islam that we have to fight. It is not Islam at all. The trouble about Wahhabism is not that we can't combat that doctrine on an intellectual level, but unfortunately, Wahhabism is being fully supported by a state with which we have friendly relations.
الوزر كله والإثم كله على المشيخات الذين هيجوا في هذه الحرب وهذه الوقيعة وهذا الدم وهذا الخزي. الإثم كله والوزر عليهم. رأينا الثكالة والنساء والأطفال الذين باتوا ويفيقون على الجوع، ورأينا أولئك الأشياخ وهم يطيرون إلى لندن وإلى تركيا طاعمين ناعمين في الفنادق وفي القصور. قالوا للناس اذهبوا إلى الحرب وإلى الجهاد المقدس. يحمل وزر هذا اتحاد العلماء الذي جعل الحرب وجعل قبلة الحرب في الشام. إنما نحن الآن نرى داعش تقتل النصرة والنصرة تقتل الجبهة الإسلامية. فيا حوبة اليرموك ويا ويل اليرموك إن اجتمع عليه هؤلاء. فإن سلموا للنصرة لم ينجوا من داعش، وإن سلموا لداعش لم ينجوا من الجبهة، وإن سلموا لهم جميعا ذبحوهم جميعا. متى يفيق هؤلاء؟ متى ندع بعضنا لبعضنا؟ ما ذنب مخيم؟ ما إذا أردت أن تقاتل لأجل أمر ما والأمر مفضوح، يقاتلون لأجل كرسي عفن وقد استبان الأمر كما رأيناه في ليبيا وفي غير ليبيا. أراد أن يقيم دولة الإسلام على دماء المسلمين، فلا دولة له ولا دين له. إنما الأمر ما قال الله وقال رسوله مللنا الكذب. أغيثوا أهل اليرموك برغيف وأغيثونا بالصدق. كفوا عنا الكذب، كفوا عنا هذا البهتان. أنبياء الله ما جاءوا بهذا ولا جاءوا لهذا. ضعوا تلك الرايات الكذابة، احموا دماء المسلمين، لا تسفكوا دماء المسلمين. فضحتم المسلمين قبل أن تفعلوا شيئا للناس.
We condemn the killing and the horrible crime committed against our Saudi colleague Jamal Khashoggi. We also denounce the violations against free speech and freedom of the press, against human rights and women's rights.
The Saudis have committed war crimes in Yemen and Syria. Tunisia's ties to Saudi Arabia are a blemish on the Tunisian revolution.
ليش الله يرضى؟ بس قل لي الله يرضى لك. زين انتوا على يا دين ماشيين؟ اريد اعرف الدين اللي ماشيين عليه انتوا. ما ماشيين على دين. لا عاد شلون تقتل البشر؟ ليش؟ ليش؟ ما عندكم روح؟
Why the Muslim has to be the victims of the mistakes of the Wahhabis? You want to stop the problem around the world? Let Wahhabi to leave us alone. We came to the West, we came to Europe, we came to America, we migrated. to go out of tyranny. You want to bring tyranny to us back? For what?
It is not merely prayers. It is singing, chanting, and dancing that Kobani's Sufi brand of moderate Islam embraces. All activities condemned by the Wahhabis and their fundamentalist form of Islam.
In America, no one knew what is Wahhabis at that time. And I begin to see this Wahhabi influence in the mosques and how they are very influential and how they are poisoning the mind of youngsters. When I saw this, all this coming, this stuff coming from these teachings of the Wahhabi sect, and Bin Laden was being doctrined with it, and he is teaching it wherever they go with his group. So in 1999, I stood up and I spoke. Oh, that was the biggest storm.
Almost 3 years before 9/11, Kobani was at this State Department conference in Washington, where he was warning about Osama bin Laden and suicide bombers.
There are 5,000 chemical suicide bomber suicide being trained by Bin Laden in Afghanistan, that they are ready to move to any part of the world in order to explode themselves. And they are very, very sophisticated. They might.
For this warning, Kobani was accused of being an alarmist and was ignored by the State Department. Frustrated, he went out to confront the Wahhabi imams across America.
So when I went and spoke with many of these scholars here in America and say, what is you are doing? You are destroying the young and the youth. You are destroying their beliefs, destroying their image. This is Wahhabi teaching. They're very extreme in their views.
You know the Al-Qaeda, how it started. I hope you still remember. Osama bin Laden was a great hero in Saudi Arabia and was supported by the Saudi government. Until 1989, he lived in Saudi Arabia and moved in and out very freely. It was in 1990 when Osama bin Laden moved to Sudan and rebelled against the Saudi government. What was the sparkling reason for that? It's not a hidden fact. It was the war to liberate Kuwait, Gulf War. So what was specific about it? It was the alliance based with some Arab countries. Several Arab countries sent troops. However, what was specific about it was seeking assistance from non-Muslims against Muslims, which Osama bin Laden considered kufr, apostasy, heresy. It makes the Muslim non-Muslim. Who told him so? How come he was convinced by this? Actually, he was taught in Saudi schools. He was taught this in Saudi schools. You know, the official doctrine of Saudi Arabia relies on the works of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. One of the major works of his is Nawaqidul Islam, a small booklet called Nawaqidul Islam. 10 principles he considers, they annihilate, they reverse your religion. They bring you out of Islam or excommunicate you. By the way, ISIS adopts Nawaqidul Islam al-Ashara of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab as they are, and they are teaching them now in all of their courses. And for irony, they are still taught in Saudi schools till today. So how do you expect not Saudis joining ISIS, rebelling against their own government, when they are taught in their own school that seeking assistance from non-Muslims makes you non-Muslims? It's an irony.
And so, in closing, I would urge you to heed the words of Iqbal Ahmad, who in this same speech in 1998 warned Americans about the dangers of Osama bin Laden, which we, of course, ignored.
A superpower cannot promote terror in one place and reasonably expect to discourage terrorism in another place. Won't work in this shrunken world.
It's like we have a secret Middle East war fetish or something, and we keep charging the credit card on brown people snuff porn and hoping our wife never finds the bill. The alt-right was anti-war and anti-neocon for all of 10 minutes at the beginning of this presidency. But when the same Bush administration warmongers who pushed us into the Iraqi war on false pretenses got Trump cabinet positions, they fell in line with remarkable speed and silence. Even the fucking Podesta group is involved, and you motherfuckers are seriously out here talking about pizza and basements instead. We act like the Muslim world was monolithic on this issue, but the king of Morocco has done more to stand up to Saudi Arabia than the entire Trump administration, refusing to receive MBS for official visits and pulling out of the Yemeni war coalition. And why do we repeatedly ask the Muslim world to condemn this when we are the ones backing it, and when that support doesn't change in the slightest from president to president, while we are never asked to distance ourselves as Americans from the jingoistic, sadistic, militaristic politics that talks about nuking and invading countries in the Middle East as casually as one might discuss what to have for breakfast? Hell, Aramco was an American company until the 1980s when the Saudis finally bought them out. It's been an American company for longer than it's been a Saudi company. We don't like to admit it, but our hands are dirty too. I don't think you're getting off that easily, British Empire. What with your Anglo-Iranian oil company, which you may better recognize by its modern-day name, BP? Why do Western governments, even those led by supposedly Islamophobic nationalist leaders, continue to back the Saudi government in spite of their long-standing support for a very niche strain of Islam that is highly associated with violence and intolerance? Because they can. Because their citizens allow it to happen through their own ignorance and inaction. Because it benefits them directly. What could be better for electing right-wing nationalists than a few hundred thousand more Yemeni refugees arriving on American or European shores? We know what bombs they're running from. We're fucking sending them there. What could possibly be a more compelling reason to throw your support behind Trump than yet another terror attack perpetrated by Islamic extremists? How else can the hundreds of billions of taxpayer dollars wasted on the Pentagon's defense contractors be justified? We get cheap oil and effective political propaganda. What a bargain. Thank you, Saudi Arabia. Most of the Muslim world is not like Saudi Arabia. Iranians, despite having suffered tremendously by the hand of the American government, are able to make a key distinction between the American people and their government. Why can't Americans do the same for other countries?
I love you,
America. Thank you. That's nice to hear.
The people are not angry with America.
Yes. Government has a lot of war to each other because their benefits. But there's no war between people.
That's a very interesting point. So the governments have a difficult time. But the people, if we meet the people, it's like this.
Yes, they're friends to each other.
Yeah, it's like this. I like that. Yeah. So for Americans, we're very religious people, but we make the government and the church apart, you know?
It's not common to each other, but in Iran, unfortunately, the religious and the politic is mixed to each other.
Yeah, so this
and
is...
And it's the main problem.
You think that's...
It's the main problem of... and it's the main point of that distance between people and government.
So you're a modern young woman.
Yeah.
Well educated.
I like to be.
Yeah. And you must wear a cover your hair.
It's a law in Iran.
It's a law.
It's a law.
America and Iran, we can be friends.
I wish the relationship between Iran and America become good.
Me too.
It's very good for body.
For the body, I bet.
Yeah.
Am I bet? They had a modern sensibility and seemed well educated. I have many friends in America that are curious about Iran. What can you tell them? What message would you give to my friends?
Your friends?
About people?
We love them.
About the people in Iran,
we love the people in America.
Yeah?
Yeah.
That's good to hear. Because we want to understand the people of Iran, and if we can make friends, it's a good thing, I think.
Yeah, it's great.
What you see on Western news media and on poll is not the full picture of the Middle East. You have, for example, Oman, which is literally right next door to Saudi Arabia, the only majority Ibadi Muslim population in the world. There has been, mashallah, until now, no Omanis joining ISIS whatsoever, and zero terrorist attacks there. For comparison, nearly 2,500 Saudis are reported to have joined ISIS. The murder rate per 100,000 people in Oman is 18, which means you are 722 times more likely to get murdered in America than Oman. There are four main schools of Islam: Hanafi, Maliki, Shafi, and Hanbali. And within that, countless differences of opinion establish over 1,400 years of legal rulings. I am only alive to make this video today because King Mohammed V of Morocco, in his wisdom, protected the Jews from any form of oppressive Nazi laws that the Vichy French government sought to impose on the Jewish subjects of Morocco. And it was one of the few Jewish communities to emerge from the tumult of the 1940s intact thanks to him. And he did this in direct accordance with his Islamic faith, as he saw Jews as his fellow people of the book, and Morocco in many ways can be a model for coexistence through shared culture to the world.
لا قالك جدود الولاء جدودنا الولاء تيقول لك جدنا واحد حنا وجدنا يهود كاملين جدودنا كانوا يهود بحال بحال صرف معاك وبيع معاك وشري معاك وحال بحال انت ما تعرفش هذاك يهودي من هذاك مسلم والحفلات كانوا دابا هاد الحفلات ديالهم حنا ورثناها منهم
بحال هاد
دابا شتي هاد اللباس هاد الخمارات اللي تيديروا بويض العرايات كسوة بيضاء وداك الشيء بجناح وهذاك الشيء كله كان اليهود
كان تفكروا مشاو اليهود على خاطر ديك الماكلة اللي موالف بكالا وكلو ما بقاتش داك حواش اللي كان لعبو ما كانش اليهود ما بغينا باش يمشيو.
You even have Moroccan Jews, which are so patriotic about their Moroccan heritage that they sing Allahu Akbar in their own private gatherings. Even though Muslims all pray to Mecca, they are also aware of how the Saudi government artificially hikes up the price of visiting, effectively extorting pilgrims, and also of how they mismanage the Hajj itself. Moroccans and Saudis don't even speak the same language. There are very, very big differences in how these two countries view the preservation of culture and the values of coexistence. We are talking about 1.8 billion people, 24% of the world's population. Of course, there's differences of opinion within that. 62% of the world's Muslims live in Asia. Three times as many as live in the Middle East. According to the Global Study on Homicide 2013, the following Muslim countries have a lower murder rate than the United States per 100,000 inhabitants. Kenya, Niger, Turkmenistan, Lebanon, Tunisia, Sri Lanka, Egypt, Bangladesh, Iran, Myanmar, Azerbaijan, Kuwait, Jordan, Algeria, Morocco, Oman, Bahrain, Qatar. The belief that all of the Muslim religion is one indistinguishable mass of baby-eating, bloodthirsty killing machines is a necessary and profitable myth to justify the unjustifiable, the American foreign policy status quo. Not all Muslims, hell, not even all Saudis, Salafis, or Wahhabis for that matter, espouse violence. And I am not endorsing war or anything of the matter. But how can we realistically claim to be tough on radical Islamic terror while we send billions of dollars in arms to the government of Saudi Arabia that we already know are ending up in the hands of ISIS and Al-Qaeda? Saudi Arabia is not going to reform the very theology at the core of their country. And let me be crystal clear, this is the government and religious leaders of Saudi Arabia specifically doing this, not average Saudi people. I think there are many beautiful aspects of Saudi and Gulf culture, and I have close friends who are Saudi, but I can't even mention them by name because I have no guarantee the Saudi government wouldn't try to pull a Khashoggi and assassinate them. 5 Saudi students have avoided criminal charges ranging from rape to murder with the assistance of the Saudi government. And what is Trump doing about this? What is any right-wing anti-Islam political group doing about this? The exact same thing Obama, Hillary, Bill Clinton, George W. Bush, and who the fuck ever did when it comes to punishing the Saudi government for any of the horrible things they've ever done. Jack fucking squat. What about Iran, you might ask? The vast majority of the Muslim world, we're talking 87 to 90% is Sunni. And even if that wasn't the case, Iran has nowhere near the money, oil, or international influence that Saudi Arabia has. Even if Iran did want to spread their ideology as much as Saudi Arabia does, they simply could not. And if you look at the largesse of international Islamist extremism today, even till today, the vast majority is Wahhabi in nature. As recently as January of 2019, there were terror attacks in Kenya organized by Al-Shabaab in Somalia, which is of course Wahhabi. These attacks also killed an American, Jason Spindler, who survived the 9/11 attacks. Oh, and remind me, how many times have Iran or Iranians directly attacked the US homeland? Zero! None! Never! It's never happened! Please, folks, they are trying to get you ginned up for yet another fucking war with Iran. Please fucking learn from mistakes and don't take the bait for once. Americans, don't give in to your lust for brown people blood just this once and save yourself a few trillion dollars and spare the lives of a few thousand soldiers. The Iranian government is fucking god awful, but if we judged every country by their political leadership, I hate to break it to you, but Americans wouldn't come off looking too hot either. Not only did we fund, arm, and train the Mujahideen of Afghanistan against the Soviets, including bin Laden, only to fight them later, not only are we currently funding the barbaric war in Yemen, which by the way, would end the instant the U.S. pulled support. Not only did we fund and build various torture facilities around the globe, which regional governments use to oppress our citizens, we have the audacity to yet again put our heads in the sand as our moderate allies start the cycle of spreading extremist Wahhabism throughout the world again, all the while we pretend we are tough on Islam and being America first. God forbid Americans care about anything outside America. What's going to happen when these Yemeni kids crawl out of the rubble of their home and see that the bomb that just blew up their entire family says "Made in America" on the side? Do we think they're gonna grill hot dogs on the 4th of July and sing Yankee Doodle Dandy? And now you mean to tell me Mr. Tough on Islam himself, Donald J. Trump, won't lift a finger to so much as stop a single bullet being sold to Saudi Arabia? What, because a couple hundred jobs at Lockheed Martin might be lost? Because Boeing might not hit their fourth quarter earning goals? And none of you insanely paranoid, creeping Sharia types see a single problem with any of this? Nobody at Britain First or UKIP has the slightest issue with the UK government under Theresa May selling British arms to Al-Qaeda at the expense of the British taxpayer? You march every day for weeks if you stumble past the Quran on the subway, but a fucking alliance with the House of Saud is the one thing that you guys are silent about? Am I suggesting this proud America First patriot can be swayed by the simple dollar alone to support things he doesn't actually believe in?
I put together some really impressive deals, but this thing you've pulled off, it's amazing. A big and tasty for just a dollar? How do you do it? What's your secret?
Got a buck? You're in luck. Because you can get a delicious, beefy, big and tasty, a McChicken sandwich, and lots of your other favorites on McDonald's Dollar Menu every day.
Together, Grimace, we could own this town.
I laugh at the mere suggestion that an ironclad patriot like Trump could be swayed to advocate on behalf of America's largest corporations for mere money alone. To the Democrats who worship Obama as a messiah, the families of the kids he blew to smithereens, including an American citizen, by the way, don't give two shits whether the guy who blew up their family was on the red team or the blue team, or whether he was black or white or nominally supported gay rights. Your total lack of principle, your messiah complex, your beyond idiotic obsession with Russia, going into conniptions because Michael Cohen talked about Russian Facebook ads, while you simultaneously are totally silent on Jared Kushner meeting with the Saudi crown prince, says more about your idiocy and deranged reactionary fixation on the entertaining but completely meaningless political theater that is the Mueller trial than I ever could, sadly. To the Republicans who abandoned all principle in lieu of fanatical Trump worship, who claim to oppose refugees and extremist Islam, except when it gets in the way of their fantasies about being Trump's personal doormat. Even a president as radical and anti-globalist or whatever the fuck Trump is supposed to be is indistinguishable on this issue in practice from Obama, Bush, or Hillary Clinton, and neither his supporters or opponents even care. Please tell me what is exactly different on policy matters from Trump and Hillary on this issue. What is the difference? Please, what is it? Where is the line? Ah, I know. Trump reversed Obama's suspension of Pave-way laser-guided missiles to Saudi Arabia until the Saudis started killing less civilians. What a big difference! Specifically changing the law to allow Saudis to buy munitions so they can slaughter Yemeni civilians with even greater ease. These same missiles were used to blow up that school bus full of children I talked about earlier and 155 people attending a funeral. The school bus was under Trump and the funeral hall under Obama. Such a rigorous debate we have in America. Such a powerful force for good in the world. Can we change? Can we give it a fucking shot? Can we try to have a single fucking minute of life pass by where someone in this country isn't trying to get us into another meaningless, poorly thought out, endless war? Just one fucking minute without a fucking idiot trying to shove us into a war. No, no, no. One minute with no war, please. 1 minute, only, just 1 minute. 60 seconds, if you can manage. Funny how Trump made a big deal of saying radical Islamic terrorism, but of course, when he spoke in Riyadh, he didn't mention it once. How come? Are we really going to go into the fucking 2020s, being the prime seller of free torture centers and child blowing up devices to horrible warmongering dictators on this planet? Are we really going to spend the next 10 years having learned nothing, changing nothing, and repeating the exact same mistakes of the past 10 years and expecting different results? Because I'm going crazy. I feel like I'm the only person left in this country, in this world, who doesn't want war. Just on principle, I think war is bad. Is that a crazy concept? That I'm anti-war? Is that a lunatic thing? That I don't want to see yet another Middle Eastern quagmire in my lifetime? That I don't want to see another $10 trillion of American money go down the drain? Can we even think Can we even think how much better our lives would be if we hadn't had two decades of war in the Middle East? Just all the trillions. Do you even know what $1 trillion is? Do you even know what $1 trillion could buy for people in this country? $1 trillion with a T, dollars? And still, you have the audacity to not learn one fucking thing about the Middle East. Still, you don't even think to question your leaders and the foreign policy status quo that has cost you trillions of dollars. Trillions with a T. Trillions. That's $900 billion plus $100 billion. $1 trillion. I don't even know how to explain it to you. So much fucking money that we've washed down the drain for nothing. Because Americans can't be fucking bothered to read one fucking chapter about the Middle East. One paragraph about the Middle East, we could have avoided the Iraq War. But no, I don't care. I don't care as long as oil stays cheap. I don't care. No matter what, I don't care. No matter how much money it costs me, no matter how many Americans die, no matter how many fucking terrorist attacks we have to endure, no matter how much misery we cause in the world, I still will refuse to care no matter what. $1 trillion, I don't care. $2 trillion, I don't care. $3 trillion, I don't care. When is it enough? When is it enough that you finally will stop and learn and think maybe this isn't the right path? Maybe another $10 trillion and 20 years of desert quagmire war is not the way for America. Maybe not. And what are we fighting for now? When people say, oh, I would just like to have cheaper college, we can't afford it. It's unthinkable. Don't even suggest the idea. It's heresy. It's Stalinism. No. But another 20 years of quagmire, another 30 years of war with Iran, another godforsaken who knows how much trillions of dollars down the drain to fight Iran. Absolutely. We don't even talk about it. We don't even think maybe it's wrong. Maybe we should have a discussion about this. We don't even think for one second, maybe I should read a little bit about this and criticize it. No, anything that's good for Americans, no, we can't afford it. If it's wasteful, if it helps Lockheed Martin's stock price go up, if it helps Boeing's stock price go up, if it kills brown people, I'm in favor. Whatever it is, no matter how much it costs, no matter how much misery it brings to the world, I'm in favor of it. As long as it costs America trillions of dollars and Americans die fighting for nothing and we spend 10 years doing nothing in the Middle East and making the world a worse place, I'm in favor of it. Without even thinking, I'm in favor of it. That's the American way. That's the American way. Rather than read one paragraph about the Middle East and who the source of terrorism is and where it's coming from, I'm just going to mindlessly support whatever my president does. Whether it's Obama or Trump, yes. Yes, I support without even thinking yes. Yes. Trillions of dollars, yes. 10 years of war, yes. How dumb is this country? How fucking brain dead, drunk at the wheel is this country that we will never learn? We will never learn the simplest lesson. The simplest lesson. It's unbelievable. It's actually, I feel like I'm literally going crazy. That we're here, it's about to be 2020. The same fucking problems of 2000 we didn't learn. The same lessons 2000 we didn't learn. Where were the terrorists of 9/11 born? Just where? Go down the list of the country. Where were they born? Why weren't they on the list of banned countries? Those two questions alone answers everything. And even just those two simple questions, Americans are so fucking stupid, so fucking mentally cocked, so insistent on their comfortable, idiotic lifestyle that, by the way, could be 10,000 times better without these garbage wars. They won't even ask the simple question. Why? When is it enough for you? When is it finally enough that people in this country are gonna say, you know what? Maybe another $10 trillion of war for nothing is not worth it. Maybe Lockheed Martin has had enough profits for two decades. Maybe we can start to even just have the idea of a discussion and start to think and maybe be a little bit more aware of it. No, the office is on, the office reruns are on, no. Despicable, what can you say?
We have people flying airplanes into World Trade Centers. We have people shooting people in California like happened last week. We have big problems. Problems that nobody understands. You don't understand them, I don't understand, people don't understand them. The Muslims have to help us figure out. There's tremendous hatred there. There's tremendous hatred. But where it comes from, I don't know.
I guess the question is there war between the West and radical Islam, or is there war between the West and Islam
itself? It's radical, but it's very hard to define. It's very hard to separate because you don't know who's who.
When I'm elected, I will suspend immigration from areas of the world where there is a proven history of terrorism against the United States, Europe, or our allies, until we fully understand how to end these threats. We need to tell the truth about radical Islam, and we need to do it now. All of the September 11th hijackers were issued visas. When it comes to radical Islamic terrorism, ignorance is not bliss. It's deadly, totally deadly, big league. Us, all of us.
They say that Mr. Khashoggi is alive or dead.
I don't want to talk about any of the facts
They didn't want to either.
Keep hearing that we're giving them some benefit of the doubt. They're going to do an investigation. And when the investigation comes out, we'll evaluate it. It's not about benefit of the doubt. It's that it is reasonable. It's reasonable to give them a handful of days more to complete it so they get it right, so that it's thorough and complete. And that's what they've indicated they need. And I'm hopeful they, and then we'll get to see it. We'll evaluate this on a factual, straight up basis.
Audio intelligence of the killing of Jamal Khashoggi. Have you heard that tape? And does it conclusively point to the Crown Prince as ordering the killing of Jamal Khashoggi? And one final one.
I suppose you remember all these?
I'll prompt you.
Thank you.
And finally, is it true the White House is blocking Gina Haspel from speaking to senators about that audio intelligence on Wednesday?
So let me take the question of the tape first. No, I haven't listened to it. And I guess I should ask you, why do you think I should? What do you think I'll learn from it?
Well, you're the National Security Advisor. You might have access to that sort of intelligence.
Yeah. How many in this room speak Arabic?
You have access to an interpreter?
Well, you want me to listen to it? What am I going to learn from? I mean, if they were speaking Korean, I wouldn't learn any more from it either.
An interpreter would be able to tell you what's
going on. Well, then I can read a transcript, too.
So you don't think it's important to hear that as a national security advisor?
I'm just trying to make the point that everybody who says, why don't you listen to the tape, unless you speak Arabic, what are you going to get from it?
I would like to thank King Salman for his extraordinary words and the magnificent kingdom of Saudi Arabia for hosting today's summit. I have always heard about the splendor of your country and the kindness of your citizens. But words do not do justice to the grandeur of this remarkable place. Yesterday, we signed historic agreements with the kingdom that will invest almost $400 billion in our two countries and create many hundreds of thousands of jobs in America and Saudi Arabia. And we will be sure to help our Saudi friends to get a good deal from our great American defense companies, the greatest anywhere in the world. Later today, we will make history again with the opening of the new Global Center for Combating Extremist Ideology, located right here in this central part of the Islamic world. This summit will mark the beginning of the end for those who practice terror and spread its vile creed. But this future can only be achieved through defeating terrorism and the ideology that drives it, or ethnicity.
I would not be in favor of stopping a country from spending $110 billion, which is an all-time record, and letting Russia have that money and letting China have that money.
Because it's America first to me. It's all about America first. Saudi Arabia, if we broke with them, I think your oil prices would go through the roof. I've kept them down.
Did MBS lie to you, sir?
I don't know. You know, who can really know? But I can say this. He's got many people now that say he had no knowledge.
What if the Crown Prince, speaking to you, the President of the United States, yeah, directly lied to you about
it? Well, he told me that he had nothing to do with it. He told me that, I would say, maybe five times.
Do you just live with it because you need him?
Well, will anybody really know? All right. Will anybody really know?
It is zero chance, zero, that this happened in such an organized fashion without the Crown Prince. As to Pompeo and Mattis, I have great respect for them. I would imagine if they were Democratic, in a Democratic administration, I would be all over them for being in the pocket of Saudi Arabia. But if they were Democratic, in a Democratic administration, I would be all over them for being in the pocket of Saudi Arabia. But if they were Democratic, in a Democratic administration, I would be all over them for being in the pocket of Saudi Arabia.
With all economic factors indicating the U.S. is heading for a prolonged recession, some experts are suggesting that the government should stop dumping all of our money into an enormous hole.